Dear students, welcome back. I'm glad you clicked on another video to make your next step in solving your complex problem. In this video, we present you the most common technique used. No doubt, most decisions in the world are based upon the results of this technique. In your role as analyst, as manager, or as consultant, you will often encounter situations in which many people are yelling against each other that their solution to the problem is the best. They try everything to convince others. The result is a big discussion and a fight with arguments. Probably familiar to you from a TV talk show, serious or less serious, the situation is always the same. A couple of people discuss a certain problem, and everybody around the table thinks he or she knows what the solution is. However, nobody really seems to listen to each other. In a situation such as this, you, as an analyst or a consultant, can quickly check people's arguments with so-called estimates, which are in essence quick and dirty calculations. Let me get this clear immediately here. It's not about checking if the numbers are correct. It is all about checking whether a numerical argument can be correct. Usually, in our role, we cannot check the argument. We, consultants, policymakers, or managers, are generalists, not experts. What we can do is finding out if the argument could be true. The added value of this quick and dirty calculating is that you can check something order of magnitude, and you can do it very quickly on the back of an envelope. If you want to study the issue in detail, it might give thick reports that nobody reads and take months to prepare. By then, the discussion, no doubt, is already about something completely different. So if we want to make an estimate, we start with questions about the order of magnitude of a certain unknown factor. For instance, how much electricity is used in a small city of around 200,000 inhabitants by all devices that are in standby modus? This factor cannot be estimated immediately. If somebody would say 6 megawatts, somebody else might say, no, 20 megawatts. If you want to estimate this number order of magnitude, you decouple this factor in subfactors, until you can make an easy estimate of such a subfactor that you can know. What subfactors, for instance? You can think about the average number of households in this city. But also that factor cannot be estimated, that is, determined within a range of 10 times smaller, 10 times larger. What you can do is estimate the average household size, say 2. So, given 200,000 inhabitants, that will make 100,000 households. And how many devices will be in standby modus in one household? A few TVs, a computer, maybe a cell phone charger that somebody accidentally left connected to the grid, say 4 devices. And how much power do these devices require? 5 watt each? Okay, then we have 100,000 households times 4 devices times 5 watts, makes roughly 2 megawatts. That is a small part of an average capacity of a power plant, around 100 to 300,000 megawatts. So that number could be true.
Hello, I am Bert van Wee, professor of transport policy at Delft University of Technology, the Transport and Logistics Group. My main research interests are in long-term policy relevant societal changes in the areas of accessibility, the environment, and safety. Suppose you want to estimate the impact of policies to stimulate people purchasing and using electric vehicles on the concentrations of pollutants and next to health effects. This is well doable as long as you split up the whole problem, which is way too complex for one model, in separate pieces of a jigsaw puzzle, which is conceptualized in this diagram. So what you do is you make estimates for all those pieces. And what you, for example, do is you look at how many people do you think will buy an electric car and use it because of the policies. And you can, for example, use experiences in other countries who have done such policies, who have implemented the policies, like Norway or the Netherlands. Then you know how many kilometers will be driven by electric vehicles. Combining that estimate with estimates for emission per kilometer of conventional cars as well as electric cars, you can estimate total car emissions. Of course, concentrations also depend on other emissions. If you have estimates for other emissions like industry or power plants, you know total emissions. And then you can look at what is the distance between emissions and where people stay. You look at the distance between the cars and where people stay and power plants that also emit. And then you can get an estimation of how much lower will the concentrations be once you stimulate the purchase of electric vehicles? More policy decisions are based on these kind of estimates than on the outcomes of one model, because there is not one model predicting in one go what policymakers want to know.
Let me give you another example of an estimate. I live in the city of Delft in the Netherlands, a small city of around 100,000 inhabitants. Many of the inhabitants are students, given the big university situated in the city. I wonder, what is the daily capacity of the two-track railway train through the city of Delft? How many hours per day does the regular train traffic take place? Say 20 hours per day. And how many trains arrive in the park then? Well, say 12 per hour, 6 in one direction and 6 in the other direction. How many people can travel in one train? Say 250. This last estimate is tricky. Somebody else might say, no, not 250, easily 1500. Or no, 70 is the max. But who is right? Probably an expert, but that person is not present here. As analysts, you quickly have to make an estimate on the back of an envelope. So, how many carriages does an average train have, and how many seats are in such a carriage? 8 and 40, respectively? Fine. Then we are done. The capacity then is 20 hours times 12 trains times 8 carriages times 40 seats is roughly 75,000 seats per day. My city has about 100,000 inhabitants, and as the trains also contains people from other cities and villages, this number could be okay when we look at the order of magnitude. If you make the calculations with your calculator, it gives you 76,800 seats per day. But watch out that you do not write it down as 76,800 seats per day. That number is far too precise. Technically speaking, it has too many significant digits. Your estimate is by far not that accurate. Formally, you should even write down 8 times 10 to the 5th power seats per day, as your estimate is for sure not more accurate than one significant digit.
Dear analysts, managers and consultants, welcome back to the part in which we work on our own case. In chapter 5 of the book, there's a section on estimates. Read and study that section first to prepare yourself for analyzing your case further. Now, turn to your scorecard. There will be quite some alternatives and quite some criteria. It is most useful if you can fill all the cells in the table. That means determining the effects of the alternatives on the criteria. There are many ways to do this. You can either look in books, articles, or search the internet. You can also set up experiments or consult experts. What you also can do is make estimates, just like you have seen in this video. So, for your scorecards, have a look at what cells cannot be filled. These you can estimate. Try it out in multiple ways so you can compare different estimates. See if you, order of magnitude, end up roughly with the same number. And what do you say to people that claim estimates are useless because the number you come up with is not correct anyhow? There are two very common mistakes many people make when estimating. They decompose factors in subfactors, but they do not decompose enough. Think about the train example of Fieke earlier in this video. Just stating that there are 250 people on a train does not make sense. People might disagree and come up with another number. This needs to be further decomposed into subfactors, like the number of carriages in a train or the number of seats per carriage. When making estimates, you're not very accurate, as you're only accurate in the order of magnitude. That's enough for its objective. However, final estimates often look far more accurate than they actually are. Stating the estimate is 6.34532 on average gives the idea that you know this number very precise, while actually that number is not more accurate than 6. Enjoy filling your scorecards with scores from many different sources, also from the estimates, as you have seen in the video. See you next time!